All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sports Chat 503 live in the building. We got Jonathan Charles in the building. What up, Jonathan?
What's good? What's good? Yes, sir. I'm happy to be here with my boy Ryan, talk about Oregon and some recruiting today.
Let's go, man. I love having you on again. I think you have a real unique perspective, being where you're at, connections with, obviously, what you do with recruiting. Now it's the on three format. Talk a little bit about kind of like where you're at, where people can find your stuff, and kind of what you're focused on.
Yeah, so follow me on Twitter on Jonathan SD underscore or SD underscore SD8. And then at ScoopDuck on three, links are going to be in the description down below. I've been working at ScoopDuck for a couple years now, and I love what I do, helping out Justin Hopkins and helping him grow his business and everything in his dream.
Yeah, shout out to J-Hop. I mean, I think that whole crew does a great job. I just love where the media is at with the amount of coverage that there is. You know, obviously, going back into the past, there was much less of it. You had to kind of seek and find certain little spots. You know, maybe you get the Phil Steele beginning of the year thing a little bit and you have something there. But now it's literally every day, all the time. Recruiting is a huge, huge industry now, and people are focused on it. People are spending money to try to get themselves the best footage or the best connection with any of the recruits or anybody else. I mean, there's a lot of angles going back and forth from the recruiting side, from the player side, and from the fan side, both trying to get information out there. So just talk really quickly about like how much recruiting has changed just in your time focusing on it, because it feels like this is an exponential growth right now.
Yeah, and especially with this whole like recruiting calendar that they changed it with the new early signing day, it makes things more interesting later on and earlier on too. And then like in the summer, it's kind of quiet. You have that like dead period, but in November, December, it's like super busy. And then in March and April, it's like picked up again because all these guys are taking their spring visits and then making commitments early on, trying to build the class for the early signing period in December too.
And I think you have an interesting kind of viewpoint as well as like how this thing plays out on the calendar, because there's some guys that want to take their visits late in the season. Yeah. There's some guys that want to take them early. There's some guys that want to commit early and get that spot locked in. There's some guys that want to wait and have one of the later spots knowing that they have kind of a guarantee. So talk a little bit about that, like the difference of these students. You know, obviously these athletes are being recruited at a very young age now. And so a lot of these things are already in play, but it seems also that some of these guys are making their decision like the morning of the press conference.
Yeah, it's crazy because some of them actually do be making it like the day of their like announcement, like 2-3 hours before. And like they don't even tell the college coaches before, like some of the parents don't even know, which is funny. Not even their like high school head coach even knows like what's the deal. So like colleges are calling the high schools, the parents and everyone, and can't get a reach. Don't know what's going on. A lot of these guys are getting offered nowadays, like in their sophomore year. Like if you're like really good, your freshman year. Also depends on the area too that you live in, which helps get exposure. Some guys like they enjoy going through the process. Like 5-star 2023 defensive end Jaden Wayne up in Washington. He's just enjoying the process. He knows he's going to have a spot, and whenever he decides to commit, whether he decides to commit in March or decides to commit in February, he still has a spot. He knows that. Whereas like a 3-star, he kind of has to commit a little earlier because he might lose his spot in the class if he's taken up by another 3-star or by a 4-star.
Yeah, it's just fascinating to me. Kind of like everybody has a certain place and time that they need to take advantage of. You know, some guys have that early hype, like you're saying, as a freshman or sophomore, the body type is right. They have an opportunity in their program to shine, and they're putting quality film on tape. And then you have other guys who, whatever the case may be, whether it be injury, whether it be fit at the high school, maybe they transfer high schools, a wide variety of reasons why they might be a late add to a lot of colleges boards. And then you have this kind of opportunity of, when do I sign? How do I sign? Do I make this big sort of gesture, you know, ESPN covered sort of time frame? I get the hats going and everything, or, you know, do I just sign, put my letter in, and I'm good to go. So I think it also kind of shows the personality of the kid a little bit too. I think this is an opportunity for some of these kids for the very first time in their life to start to build their brand. And we know now with NIL and everything else that some of these kids' brand might be the biggest it ever is in their career coming out of high school. They might not ever achieve what people have for the expectations for them. So just it's just a wild time right now when you start talking about this, because this is a weird time that we've now moved this signing day up. So there's these guys that have already signed. Then you have this kind of tweener period between the early signing day and the actual signing day, and you're starting to get some more guys coming in, right? But they haven't signed yet officially, so they're hard commits or something, right? Whatever the terminology is. And it seems like right now there's a lot of buzz around what's next, how many spots are left, and now you start doing the math. And I think this is kind of the coolest part of this whole process. You know, years ago, with Major League Baseball, when they were the best thing in all the sports world, you know, people just kind of fell off and didn't pay attention to the offseason. Then they started to have the hot stove and everything, try to keep things moving, right? People talk about the offseason stuff. I think college football is in the exact same thing right now. They have their regular season, they have their bowl season, and now they have their kind of offseason recruiting time and transfer portal time.
Yeah, and some of these kids, like, their announcements, whether it be, like, live on TV or, like, with their news station, like, it's pretty cool. Or, like, when they post on Twitter their, like, commitment video, like, some of these guys actually, like, post a story, like, to their life and what their career, what their high school career meant, or even their youth days, and just telling them about themselves and, like, of course, getting their brand up with the NIL and how these, like, colleges can help out. And then like, in this late cycle that Oregon's going through currently, for example, like, they're looking at these guys that flew under the radar the whole cycle. And then now that these schools are calling now, and these kids are getting more exposure now during this, like, tweener period between December and February.
Yeah. How do you think the change of the coaching staff, what do you think that did for this recruiting class? What do you think the impact is, big picture? Because obviously we know that things change, right? The coaching staff, the philosophy changes, the identity, maybe the projection of how well they'll play in the system, or whatever the case may be. There's a tremendous amount of changes, obviously, personality changes as well as personnel changes. So talk about that. What do you think the impact was with Cristobal leaving and the Dan Lanning era starting?
Yeah, if you like kind of like kept an eye, you saw that there was a bunch of decommitments because of the guys that Mario and his staff had previously, like Landon Hullaby, Texas safety, Kelvin Banks, Texas offensive tackle, Cameron Williams. Those three guys, they all had connections to Mario. They all had connections to their positional coaches. And then they just figured it'd be best for them to go somewhere else, that they had a relationship with someone at another school, which is totally understandable. You know, you can't be mad at the kid for wanting to stay closer to home, or because they felt more comfortable at a school.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, I think it, big picture, that the having the COVID year and having that extra year might help this recruiting class. The fact that this might not be as big as you wanted it to be, or as fruitful as you wanted it to be, you know, having that extra year for some of these guys, that might actually be a little bit of the band-aid you need for this. And because, you know, going forward, this coaching staff's going to recruit.
Yeah. And the whole COVID thing didn't help. Like, this is probably like the 2022 class is probably the last class that's going to be affected by this. I don't think the 2023 class is going to be affected at all, because they'll have the whole 2 years that they went through with last year and this year with getting camp exposure, tape out, full seasons in their huddle film. So I think the 2022 class was the last class to be affected by COVID, but I think from here on out, I think they'll be okay.
Yeah, I wonder if COVID over the whole country made kids maybe stay closer to home or reconsider certain offers and go with maybe the safer option, or commit early because they might not know if that even would still be available for them. Or I wonder if those things went in people's mind.
Yeah, I feel like that's going to play a huge part. I feel like we're going to see a lot more of the transfer portal this year, for sure, because of those 2021 guys that were affected by COVID, because they weren't able to take their visits. It was just kind of just like, well, see the campus if you can, and if you can't, like, we'll have this virtual visit for you, which doesn't help at all because you can't really see the environment, how the people are, what the school is like, you know. And it's just those small details that make a difference when you're visiting campus in person.
So what do we got next? We know who they've already signed. We know who the commitments are now. Justice Lowe, the last one, it feels like that it went jumped on that list, a local guy from up here in the Portland area. What's next? How many spots do they have? How many spots do they want to fill? Obviously, there's still question marks about the running backs, who's coming back, transfer portal stuff. So what's next on the horizon?
Yeah, so in regards to the running back position, they'll take at least one more guy. I think depending on whether Dia comes back or Verdell, because it's safe to assume that both of them won't come back. Especially now that Dye's in the portal, he can decide whether he wants to come back to Oregon or wants to go somewhere else and go where his options are at. But I think Oregon's going to take one running back. And then for the whole class, I think they're probably going to take 18 to 22. I posted on Twitter saying the same thing. And then I'll be on Twitter later this week, probably today or tomorrow, probably talk about it. With the Oregon space guys.
So maybe like 7 to 9, 10 more players at the very most, are we thinking that would be what we're looking at?
Yeah, because we're currently at 13. So there's 7 signed players, 3 commits, and then the 3 transfers with Bo Nix, Sam Taki, and Christian Gonzalez.
So again, I think this is kind of the new age, right? So you have to manage a lot as a recruiting staff, right? Because you're looking at guys who could transfer now. That's a whole new possibility, right? You've been recruiting guys for 2 or 3 years. They go to school A. You might have them still on your board as a possibility to transfer. There are guys who you're looking at projecting in 2 or 3 years to be starters that might not ever make it, so you might need to hit the transfer portal to fill some spot if they don't pan out. You have guys who you got to think, how do you fill a spot if a guy leaves early? You have a real stud who might leave for the draft early or whatever. How are you going to fill that spot? So it feels like there's the normal recruiting stuff that we've always had, but now it feels like there's a whole separate side of it that just has to track the portal and the possibility of who's going where around the country pre-portal.
Yeah, and it's hard for these coaches because they have to look at their positional groups, and even Coach Lanning, he has to look at the whole roster like 2-3 years down the road, because he has to, like, for example, like, see, like, oh, Justin Flo might leave after this season. I can't guarantee he's going to stay for 2 years. Or like Ty Thompson, he might leave in 2 years, you know, like those little things in terms of roster management. And then even looking at the transfer portal, making sure that they're the right character for your program, and making sure that they can be a difference maker on your team too. So it's a juggling of both worlds of the prep level and the transfer level, which is hard.
Well, and it seems like, you know, with a new coaching staff, you're going to hit the transfer portal a little harder, right? You might have guys like Christian Gonzalez come in with a Coach Meat, who he already has a relationship with, or Sam, or, you know, Bo Nix having the – all these guys have connections to at least one member of this coaching staff that have come in. It'll be interesting to see how that plays out in the future, because – I think people are going to go to the transfer portal and look for playing time, right? You're a junior. You need to have one more year or 2 more years. You're a sophomore. You need to hit up a breakout year. You're not fit in your thing. Maybe a Micah Pittman situation where you could be a starter, but you're still not getting the rock. So you still need to get to a better spot if you want to get to that next level. It'd be really interesting to see how that transfer portal plays out in the future.
Yeah, and I don't think Oregon's going to be hitting the transfer portal just as hard as I think they will be in the future. I think they'll probably take like 1 or 2 guys, like, from the portal. Of course, if there's like an elite guy that's worth taking, then, you know, you try and take a crack at it and see what you can get. But yeah, I think this year is probably the bigger year that they're going to take out of the portal, because they already have three portal guys, and I'm figuring that they're probably going to take one or two more. And of course, depending on who enters too, and try and intrigue the idea.
And those three portal guys are instant impact players. I
Yeah.
mean, obviously, we know the story with Bo Nix, but Christian Gonzalez, man, he was a great player for Colorado last year. And I do think that Big Sam, he's going to be in the middle too. He's going to be in the rotation. I mean, a 2-year starter at Washington, you're obviously the guy. I mean, so I think the
Yeah.
transfer portal this year is going to be very impactful.
Yeah, and then talking about Christian Gonzalez too, like he even held his own against Drake London, who's considered a first round talent, or might even go in the second round when USC and Colorado played. And you see it on the film that he just couldn't get separation, which is really going to help in conference play, and even against Georgia to start the season off.
Well, and next year's defense looks very good. I mean, you start penciling some of these guys in at certain positions, and next year's defense could be really nice. Guys come back healthy.
Yeah, and it was just a really, really weird year with injuries. I'm sure at this point I've heard everyone's pretty healthy. The only one that I've heard that's going to be out for spring is Bo Nix and Keion Ware-Hudson. Bo Nix with, of course, his ankle injury, and then Keion with he's got a shoulder and a knee issue going on that he's getting fixed, but he's on the mend. But they'll be both back for fall camp.
Yeah, the big story I think is the quarterback thing, right? And I think that for all the people in the Ty Thompson camp, you know, this might be the best situation you could have had, right? Having Bo Nix not be there for the spring, Ty's gonna get all the opportunity in the world to shine in this thing, and you're gonna continue to build that pressure on this coaching staff to have a very honest competition come fall. Obviously, both these guys can play. But it's going to be interesting to kind of see the proven versus the unproven, the maybe lower ceiling versus the higher ceiling conversation start, right?
Yeah, like for me, I want the younger guy only because of the fact that it's going to benefit the team long term, whether it be Ty or whether it be Jay Butterfield, going into next year and then the 2023 season. But Bo Nix also adds that experience step in the room, whereas like if they don't feel comfortable starting Ty or Jay, they can go with Bo Nix as the starter. And it gives you some experience depth in it. And I have seen the tape on Bo Nix. There are moments where I'm scratching my head, but there are other moments where I'm like, okay, he made this really good play. And I think Coach Dillingham can turn him around and do well in this offense. I think if Bo Nix does start, which I do believe it is an open up competition, just FYI to everyone. But if Bo Nix were to start, I think he is going to do well in this offense.
Yeah, I think he has just as much of an opportunity to be successful here as he could in any other position that's available. It probably even more so here, based on the fact that you do have talent out here, you have a team that's been fairly successful, and you have that relationship with the offensive coordinator. So hopefully, if all those things play out, you would assume that'd be a positive for the program. I mean, but the Jay Butterfield conversation is very interesting because it feels like people don't really talk about him that much. He throws a beautiful ball. If this thing is a passing offense, focused on the passing offense, he might actually be one of your better options.
And people discredit Jay Butterfield's mobility. He's not that bad. He's probably very similar to Justin Herbert's mobility in terms of getting away and then running for a few yards if he needs to, like second and third or third and five, whatever the case may be. But yeah, Jay Butterfield probably does throw the best ball out of the three of them.
And he's the most prototypical quarterback. When you look at him, he looks like the classic quarterback, right? The big arm, tall
Yeah.
guy in the pocket, strong, like you
Intelligent.
said. Yeah, and like you said, more athletic than people give him credit for, but yeah, can make the play when he needs to, get the first down. I mean, his tape in high school is pretty ridiculous. And I do think that he has an opportunity going into this thing just as much as anybody else. This spring's going to benefit him not having Bo Nix around as well.
Yeah, and we'll see a good showcase for the spring game, which I'll be there to watch in person with me and my dad. So I'm excited about that one. Yeah, it's gonna be fun to see those two go at it.
So who are some of the guys who are going to be the early commits? I think that's one of the other things. We have the early commits, but we also have the early additions, guys who leave their high school. They're here for this spring whatever the term we call this right now, I guess spring terms, and still we're in the winter. Who are some of the guys who are going to be able to get here early and participate in the spring?
Yeah, so Devin Jackson will be here spring practice. Anthony Jones is already here on campus. And then I don't know about the rest of the guys, but I do know that Christian, Sam, and Bo, of course, are on campus to start for winter term. So they're currently here.
Let's talk about Anthony Jones a little bit. He seems like an incredible add to this team that maybe he was not a part of the early commit process as a younger player in high school. It feels like maybe he was a late add. Am I right with that?
Yeah, so Sir Mel's, I've spoken to Sir Mel's. He's teammates with Sir Mel's. I've spoken to Mel's about where Anthony Jones was at with his recruitment. At one point, Anthony was supposed to take a visit to Oregon secretly during the season. I don't remember which game. It was like somewhere in October. And then Anthony just decided to flip to Oregon last minute. Even his mom said on Twitter that it was just that day decision, and Anthony just decided, you know what, Oregon's the best fit for me, and I'm going to do what's best for me. And he felt sorry that he had to say goodbye to the Texas coaches, because he built that whole relationship with them. But Anthony's going to play the edge spot. He's going to be able to play, off the edge, playing KT's role, kind of the same as Mace Funa.
Yeah, and he's a big dude. I mean, his tape looks incredible. I mean, I don't really know how the star system works that well, and I kind of don't really focus that deeply on that. I try to look at the film, and out of all these guys, I mean, his film jumps out. It could be just because of his size and strength and the position he plays, but he looks like a man among boys on his film.
Yeah, and I think he's very undervalued for a star rating. I think that Anthony would have been a 5-4 star, probably mid-4, somewhere in that range.
Yeah, and what about Sir Mel's? Because Sir Mel's had kind of an interesting week. He, you know, these guys post these very cryptic Twitter, you know, with the like a emoji of the guy with the scratching the beard, or you know, a wizard hat or something. You don't even really know what's going on with it. But and then he jumped on his own space. He hosted his own space, or he was on the Oregon space, or whatever the case may be. But I listened to that. He had his mom in there with him. Mm-hmm. Talk about Sir Mel's a little bit, because it seems like he's a guy who is another guy who body type wise feel like he can make a difference very early on.
Yeah. So he felt upset. There was some cryptic tweet last week that he posted on Twitter and said that there was some miscommunication with the staff, but everything's good, everything's resolved. That's kind of where he said on Twitter. And then I, with his frame, 6'5", 300 pounds, I think he said 310. He's just a guy that just needs to reform his body. He's going to be a developmental guy, be in the program 3-4 years, and then he'll make an impact at some point in his career.
So biggest guy so far in this recruiting class, who would you say is the apex guy so far in the group?
Currently, probably Christian Gonzalez. He's probably the guy that I would say that's going to make the biggest impact so far right now.
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, he's a guy who on film, you know, obviously it's nice to watch college film versus high school film to really get a gauge of who the guy is. But you're right. I mean, I put on the film of him, the USC film as well, and was very, very impressed. Not to mention the fact that he's already got the connection with position coach, everybody else there. I do think the transfer portal is going to change college football more than probably anything else that we've seen, especially for teams that like maybe Oregon State, who could be just maybe a couple players away from making a jump, or, you know, a Cal team that's kind of trying to kind of re-identify themselves, be able to add some talent through the portal. I think it's going to be a huge deal. And this year for the Ducks is going to be a big one.
Yeah, whether you're like a big team, big time team, whether you're like Oregon or Alabama, they're entering the portal to get these guys, and like Oregon State, they're entering the portal too. So you could be a low tier team or a high tier team and still take advantage of the portal, which helps. And like Oregon State, they're doing it right. They're taking some prep guys, and then they're taking some portal guys too to help with helping to be a better team.
Yeah, well, I think those guys, they, you know, just as much as Oregon, everybody's dealing with depth, right? And the better programs have the better depth. I mean, there can be across the board great talent in the ones, but it's about how the twos do, how the threes do in practice, how you handle injuries. We talked about this Duck defense last year. I mean, you had Jeff Bossa move from a safety to a linebacker because there's just no linebackers. I mean, it was I've never seen anything like it last year.
Yeah, and with Bossa, I feel like he's going to move to linebacker just because with his frame, and of course him only being a true sophomore, he's barely growing to his body. So I think he's probably a better fit at that outside linebacker inside will spot.
Yeah, and you don't know what's going to happen, obviously, when these guys come back from injury, but it seems interesting that he could be somewhat of a flex even and run, you know, somewhat of that hybrid safety linebacker that the NFL loves right now.
Yeah, and it helps with his versatility. Coach Powledge, Coach Lapoy can move him around, move him to safety if they need to, move him as a box safety.
Yeah, and be able to have your heavy packages or whatever the case may be. I remember when they had in the Rose Bowl against Wisconsin, they started all the heavy safeties rather than some of the lighter guys and have kind of different packages for different teams. What do you think for the Polynesian Bowl this week? I always kind of like the Poly Bowl, and I always kind of like to see they always have, it seems like, some really, really high-end talent, like some of the best in the country go out there. And then they also have, you know, a mix of West Coast guys that I think Oregon has their eyes on. I know Ben Roberts is over there, and I know there's other guys over there who are trying to maybe get on the team, or Ducks are trying to add to it. And then Trajan Williams, I think, is also over there this week. But what are your thoughts on the Polynesian Bowl?
Yeah, I think it's a really good bowl. I think it's a fun one for all the prep guys to go into. It's just a really cool experience to be able to go to another state and play. And then just kind of experience the Polynesian life. I know they do some sort of like, I know they do a bunch of Polynesian activities.
Too. Well, I just think it's a cool connection where you have a lot of the Poly kids be able to play with some of these guys. It's almost like instead of having everybody come from the islands to the mainland and play in these bowl mm-hmm. games, people are going to the islands to play.
And that's pretty cool, especially to be able to experience the Polynesian life and what it's like and learn about the Poly culture.
And from a Duck fan, you know, if you go to their website, immediately when they post, you know, like their, you know, their banner or whatever, it's just full of Duck names. It's like the Polynesian Bowl where the greatest players like DeForest Buckner, Marcus Mariota. I mean, these guys are all on this thing. It's pretty good.
Yeah, it's pretty cool to see where these guys go at, and like DeForest Buckner and Marcus Mariota being the biggest guys on the team.
You know, a couple of years ago, we saw Robbie Ashford over there play very well. Justin Flo played very well. So it's also kind of a place where it feels like, as a Duck fan or as West Coast fans, because you can go kind of see maybe who the next player is, play against some pretty good talent. And I think that's the coolest thing, going back to the conversation about how this has grown with the recruiting, is the camps. I think the camps are really, and the bowls and all these kind of things where you start to bring the all-star kids together, is really the coolest thing we have. And to have this much footage of all these different things is really cool as well, I think, right now.
Yeah, and it helps. Just get more exposure for these guys. Just kind of enjoy their last ride in high school, being able to try some new uniforms. Because those Poly uniforms are pretty cool, especially with the helmet that they do.
Oh, yeah.
Every year. Yeah, it is just different.
Like, I remember Flo, he was like out like it, modeling the thing, like walking around downtown Honolulu with the shirt tucked underneath the thing, you know.
That's pretty cool because they can add their own little twist to it, like Flo does.
Absolutely. So what are your thoughts? We haven't talked about the coaching staff that much. What are your thoughts on some of these guys? Who are some of the guys on the coaching staff that stand out to you? Who are maybe some of the guys, obviously we know the big names, but maybe some of the guys who might be the better recruiters out of the group or might be certain people to look for in the future?
Yeah, so Coach Lapoy, he's getting paid $1.7 million a year. Of course, with his recruiting chops at his previous stop at Alabama. And then, of course, his coaching experience in the NFL with the Browns and Jaguars being the most recent team this season. And then Coach Palage with the safeties, Coach Martin at corner, Junior Adams, which was a big steal from the Huskies, always showed down the rival team.
And I thought that was a big, just to jump in on Junior Adams for a second, I thought that was a big one because he was only one of two coaches that was retained by DeBoer. So it's like the fact that he gets retained and gets the job basically and then gets poached by the Ducks is pretty funny.
Yeah, that was pretty funny, especially he resigned too. And then being able to be kept by DeBoer, that was a big steal for Oregon. And then, but yeah, he's definitely going to help in the West Coast recruiting and being able to keep the West Coast receivers either to Oregon or, yeah.
Now, what do you think about the big picture? Like, what are the changes this program is going to do or program? What do you think they're going to do big picture? Like, you know, Mario definitely beefed this team up, focused on the trenches, focused on maybe playing a little bit more old school football and maybe 3 yards in a cloud of dust as opposed to what we saw before, which was the super spread and the blur offense and everything else. What do you think this coaching staff's going to be known for? What do you think this coaching staff's focus is going to be?
Yeah, so from a recruiting philosophical standpoint, all the coaches, even Coach Lanning, they're going to prioritize the South. They're going to go after the guys in the South. There's just more D-line and offensive line guys there, Texas East. And then athletically, they're still going to grab the top best guys from the West and then venture out East for the guys that they think either can be just as good as the West Coast guy or better. And then from an offense standpoint, they're going to run a lot of RPO. It's going to be a lot of that spread the ball out and then hit you deep. When they get the chance. I don't think Oregon's going to be running just as much. I think they're going to be passing a lot more, especially with the quarterbacks that they have on roster right now. And then defensively, they're going to be running the 3-4 defense, attacking wise and blitz a lot with the linebackers and use your personnel to the best of their abilities.
Well, you would think that the defensive side is going to get most of the attention here for sure, right?
Yeah, because schematically, they're going to be able to plan a really good defense with Coach Palage coming from the Dave Aranda coaching tree and then Coach Lapoy coming from the Bama Saban NFL tree.
Well, and I think also your best talent is on the defensive side.
Yeah, and it helps too, especially with Justin Flo and Noah Sewell being able to blitz, cover, do everything. They're a jack of all trades at linebacker.
The guy on offense I'm interested in is Adrian Clem. I think that he comes in and has probably the most solid group of the whole team outside of maybe the linebacker core. When you deal with the amount of snaps these guys have had, the consistency that this team has had, this offensive line group, I think they're the most seasoned of the whole team. It's got to be nice for a guy like Clem to be able to come in and have a pretty solid group that's got leadership, that knows what they're doing, that is pretty solid up front.
Yeah, and they're pretty much like three deep currently. I think they have 13 guys, 13 or 14 right now, considering Logan Sagapolo's in the portal right now. So they can get a good rotation in. Coach Clem can figure out who's the five best guys for the first team and second team, and those guys are just young pups growing into their bodies, learning how to use their frame, how to use their hands, and Coach Clem is in a really good spot with those guys.
Well, I agree. I was not surprised to see Logan hit the transfer portal, but it was tough, you know, as a guy who likes the offensive line. You know, I know a little bit about what they're trying to do, and I know that guy throws the weight around. He is like one of by far the strongest guys on that squad, just is in freak strength. So it was kind of a tough one to see him go after obviously seeing Kinsley go early in the year. To see both those guys that, you know, you kind of had some seriously high hopes for this Oregon program, just couldn't stick it out, couldn't wait the turn.
Yeah, and it sucks about Logan because he was if he I think he probably could have made a difference with Coach Clem coaching, but there's just so many guys, and especially with the portal, you just try and take advantage of it and not sit too long at a spot and go somewhere else.
Yeah, it'd be crazy to see both him and Kinsley in the BYU uniform next year if that goes down.
Yeah, that'd be a crazy offensive line.
Well, they're already good, but you want to talk about deep? You know, their guys over there are like 24.
Yeah.
How do you crack that? How do you crack that lineup? Well,
That's
I do think it's going to be fascinating, this team. So, what do we think about this next year and the next year's schedule? What do you think about opening the thing up at Georgia, the storybook? I mean, Disney couldn't have even written a better storyline here with this one. The fact that you have the defensive coordinator from Georgia now facing his former team. I mean, what a showdown that's going to be. And all the summer of hype on ESPN. That's the other thing I think is crazy about that game is that you're going to see that ticker across the bottom of the ESPN with that red G and that yellow, green and yellow O the whole summer.
Yeah, and I feel like it's going to be a top 10 matchup because Georgia's probably going to be right there in the top four, and then Oregon probably at the eight through 10 spot. That one's going to be exciting. There's going to be a lot of eyes. It was funny that Coach Lanning even said in his press conference at Oregon that that Coach Smart had to take him off the staff techs. I think Oregon's going to fall short by no more than 10 points, but I do think it'll be a close one.
Yeah, I think it's a win-win. I think I don't think it hurts the program at all to take a loss out there if they do. And if they win, then it's a huge win. Very similar to how I felt about the Ohio State situation, right? I mean, knowing that they were going to get that home and home with Ohio State, of course, we were very excited to host the game. And then when that got canceled, you know, we were still excited to play the game out there. But going into that game, I had some, you know, real concern thinking, again, this is just a behemoth. Ohio State every single year is the guy and the team. And now you have to beat them at their place. It's going to be very difficult. What happens? The Ducks go out and do it in just amazing fashion. And this could play out very similarly. I mean, we know that teams have a tough time after they win the national championship, coming back and playing that first game. Weird stuff has happened. So I agree. I think if Oregon keeps it close, maybe they're ahead at halftime, that sort of situation. You come out of there with your head held high.
Yeah, and Georgia's replacing a lot of guys on defense, which is going to help. Especially to expose that defense right there with a bunch of freshmen and first time starters, but yeah, I think if Oregon can keep it close, and then the football is funny, it can always take a funny bounce and go in one team's favor.
Absolutely. So, what are your thoughts for next year? What are your thoughts on maybe win-loss record or kind of maybe some of the big games or games that maybe are trap games? For me personally, it's that those last three games of the year are just going to be brutal. Washington, Utah, and Oregon State in a 1-2-3 to end the year. But the beginning of the season is going to be difficult too.
Yeah, I think Oregon's gonna go 10-2. I think they're gonna go to the Pac-12 championship and then probably go to the Rose Bowl. That's probably the most realistic expectation that Oregon fans can have. Anything better than that is just icing on the cake. I think they are gonna trip up against Georgia, and then I think they are probably gonna trip up somewhere else along the line.
Yeah.
But if they do get out of the Georgia game and go 11-1, then they're in a really good spot.
Absolutely. Now, what about the opportunity for it to go like a 7-win season or an 8-win season? I mean, again, I think Duck fans might have to buckle up for the possibility. There's going to be some tough games next year.
Yeah, especially depending on who starts at quarterback, there might be some moments where Oregon fans are struggling or are having a hard time. But it is a possibility that Oregon does go seven wins or 8 wins. But it's not a bad year if they go that low. But I do think the lowest ceiling for them is, or the lowest floor for them is 9 wins, just based off of talent and scheme and the coaches that they got.
I would tend to agree. I just think that, anything happens. You don't really know exactly what you're getting the coaching staff. I mean, again, when we had the Chip Kelly era, I always tell that story that the first game with Chip Kelly, you have a brand new head coach, a brand new offense, or a brand new athletic director, a brand new head of the Pac-12, and they're all up at Boise, and the Ducks don't get a first down in the first half. The thing looks absolutely brutal. You couldn't have had a worse offensive production, it felt like, in that game. And then the game ends with a fight, and LeGarrette Blount punches the guy and is out for the rest of the year, dang near. It's like you couldn't get a worse start than that. And that's Chip Kelly. That's the guy that we've put on the freaking Mount Rushmore of coaches. So obviously it's going to get better, but you can't have a worse start than that. This is a year where technically you could go to Georgia, like you said, maybe lose a close game. Come back. Eastern Washington's going to be tough. They're obviously should be a win, but then you got BYU. No Pac-12 school thought they were probably going to lose to BYU last year, maybe outside of Arizona or something. BYU's 5-0 against the Pac-12 last year, and they return guys. That could be a heck of a game. If Oregon trips against them, you could have a 1-3 start to start the year. Duck fans would be going crazy. At that point, if you started Bo Nix, maybe now you're starting Ty Thompson. I mean, what in the heck? You could write a storyline that could go completely down the drain.
Yeah, that would be a really bad start. But Ryan, how deserved it?
I mean, it's gonna get wild, man. Like, I personally, for me, I think you, like you're saying, I think you're gonna be right. I think there's gonna be somewhere in the 9-win zone, right? Could be 8, could be 10, but I'm gonna be tight, man. I'll be at that BYU game, and I'm kind of stressing over that. And then it's tough to play on the road at Arizona. Arizona is a
I'll be at that
great.
one.
You'll be at that one. Okay, that's great.
I'll be at that one.
Start the Pac-12 at Washington State. That's brutal. Don't know what they're gonna have. That place gets rocking. You get down by a touchdown up there, it's like the loudest stadium in the conference, 30,000 people. And then you come down, and you've got to have you're all your P's and a Q. You have to maybe you go to Boulder. I mean, there's some weird stuff in this schedule. So not to say that the Ducks are just going to steamroll through it. I think the Ducks have the talent, like you're saying, and with this coaching staff, they should be favored in most of those games. But man, if you come out and lose and you go 1-3 to start with, wow.
Yeah, that's going to be a rough start. But it's crazy because this conference too did change a lot, because there's a lot of quarterback change across the board. Like with Washington State, they lost Delora. Of course, UCLA is bringing DTR back. USC is going to start a new quarterback. So there's a lot of change within the conference for quarterback play.
Yeah, I think Arizona is going to be markedly improved. I think adding Delora is going to really help them. It felt like the end of the year that team played a lot better than at the beginning of the year. They didn't see the wins maybe, but they were playing a lot better football. They're going to have a really good spring. That's just a tough place to play. Tucson's just always a rough one.
Yeah, that climate sucks for sure.
Well, they bear down there, dude. They get fired up.
Yeah, but hopefully it's a good, fun experience. And I think Oregon's gonna start. Was it 2-1 for the first 3 games?
I agree. I think they'll beat BYU, but I think that's going to be a close one. I mean, I don't think anything's going to be a blowout early for this team.
Yeah, it'll be a fun season for sure. I'm excited. I want to see how the quarterback room plays out, and then probably I'm a defensive guy, so I want to see some good defense.
Absolutely. And I do think that's the difference maker, right? If the Ducks have a good defense, they're in it. And the way that this team lines up next year, you better take advantage of this defense, because it felt like maybe this year you didn't quite take advantage of the opportunity. Now, again, you had a tremendous amount of injuries, but everybody's got to deal with injuries. But it felt like this year you got burned big time in the middle. I mean, they were one of the worst third down conversion defenses in the country, and their offense was one of the best. So, I mean, if you just were to be able to put together some stops, give your offense a chance, maybe people aren't so down on this Ducks offense.
Yeah, and I wasn't very impressed with the Gruiters defense this year. I know injuries played account of it, but Oregon's corners were playing 7 yards off the ball. They were playing a lot of bend but don't break. Oregon just couldn't get the other team off the field on third downs, which really, really hurts. But defensively alone, I think this year, I think they will be able to turn around. I think probably they'll average probably within the top 50 for defenses this year.
I would agree. I tend to think this could be a year like we saw the first year Avalos took over, where you made just a humongous change and there was a humongous difference. I do think that this is going to be a year where if Oregon can come out and play the defense we think they're going to play, they're in the conversation. And all you need to do is be there at the end and have yourself an opportunity. I do think that everybody in the conference is going to be improved. I think the teams are getting better. I think the conference is getting better as a whole. And Oregon's going to have their hands full. But having teams like Washington at home, Stanford at home, UCLA at home, that's going to be a big schedule for this team and this brand new coaching staff, Autzen, to get back and rocking again. Because, you know, to be fair, you know, Cristobal coached during the COVID era, and the COVID era kind of rocked this program a little bit and the fan base a little bit as well. You know, we didn't see any sellouts, really. The only sellout we saw this last year was the Beeb game at the end of the year. And, you know, so I expect the energy to come back into this program I expect the excitement to build. And I think that if they come out and get some big wins early in this thing, you could have a rocking Autzen Stadium this year.
Yeah, and winning helps resolve a lot of issues. I think it is disappointing to see that the fans don't fill up the stadiums more at Autzen. I know we were talking about it on Twitter space that these late starts don't help, and just getting down the I-5 sucks. I wouldn't know what that's like, but I'm sure a lot of people know a lot better than me that's hard.
It is what it is, though. It is what it is, man. I mean, if you're dedicated, you want to be there, you got to get there. Eugene being in the middle of the state, I know a lot of my buddies from Southern Oregon, they come up. I'm in, you know, Portland, we go down. You know, I know every single way to get down there. I jump off I-5, I'm on 99. I'm floating through country roads. I'm doing all back roads the whole way. You know, you got to find a way to get there. And I do think it's important enough to get there. But let's talk about Twitter spaces before we go. Okay, we got to talk, because, dude, Twitter spaces is legit. I'm a big believer. I grew up as a kid loving sports radio. I just love to talk about sports. Obviously, this is my platform that I'm here chatting. But the Twitter spaces was legit. Obviously, the big one was during the Dan Lanning, before he was announcement, his brother jumps in. His brother's hosting one yesterday, right? Am I right?
Yeah, his brother was hosting one yesterday, last night.
Yeah, so it's like, how crazy is this? Parents coming in. When Rob came in, dude, when he came in, he was like, hey, I'm on my wife's burner account. I mean, I was listening through that whole stretch, and it was just, I was so impressed. I was so impressed, and I'm so impressed with those guys. So happy for it. It gives everybody a platform. And I also think the biggest win out of this whole thing is people's love for James Kropia. I think Kropia has now elevated himself in the Duck fandom, who paying attention, because it felt like people were kind of anti-James a little bit because of his questions, because of Cristobal's reactions sometimes. They were maybe... I love the questions because he's asking direct personnel questions every single time. Who's healthy? Who's not? Who's playing? Who's in the two deep? That's what I want to know. So James is a guy who gives quality info. Yeah. I love Max Torres questions. Tyson Alger, I think, asks the best questions, gets the best laughs or whatever. But, man, I'm telling you, this was a team this year. It was just so crazy to watch and to see Twitter spaces kind of evolve out of that, because I do know guys like Lacavelli, he was running stuff, Bistro running stuff, you know, guys who doing after the game talking about, and all those guys have been on here on my sports chat. I'm a fan of all those guys. But those guys were running these Twitter spaces after the games, and I was checking in on them here and there, but it was only like, you know, 30, 40, 50 people maybe at the most. Yeah. Then the whole thing switches after the coaching staff, and there's like now a Twitter space going on at almost any time of the day, anywhere, talking about the Ducks.
Yeah. I also wanted to start off, make sure you go follow, if you guys are on Twitter, go follow London, Mate, and Don. I'm always there. Give them a follow. If you follow me, you can follow them. Or Ryan, I know, is all on all the time. But that was crazy to see Ryan, Rob Mullins. We had, I think, 2,200, 2,000 people on it. We've even had Kenny Weeden. We've had Kenny Farr. Kenny Farr came on yesterday.
Love the Kenny Farr one, man. Kenny was breaking some knowledge down. It was awesome.
Yeah, and then I am in the works with London on bringing some of the current Oregon players, and then get those players some money with the paid Twitter spaces. So it'll be fun. It'll be a lot of good talks and everything.
Talk about that. What is the Twitter, the next involvement? What is the pay for Twitter sort of situation? What are we talking about there for the promoted spaces, or what does that look like?
Yeah, so I applied a few days ago, just to help with the Twitter management stuff. I know London, one of our guys on Twitter. He's constantly running Twitter Spaces. He got approved for the paid Twitter Spaces. The paid Twitter Spaces is you can pay a certain dollar amount, and collect that money, of course, to that celebrity or to that player. We can charge either $1 or $5, whatever, for it per
So
person.
you could have a player come in to a Twitter space and then have people pay a dollar each to get in the Twitter space, and then that money can go to that player for hosting that space or answering questions or whatever the case may be. Love it. And NIL wise, that's all above board, U of O. Now we're all concerned because the NCAA, right, is now, surprise, surprise, they're looking at Oregon, right?
Yeah, I think a Husky fan ratted us out.
Oh, for sure. For sure. Oh gosh. But yeah, that I think that's great. And I do think the Twitter space is a very organic place. I'm a guy who, again, I go to the games, and when I'm at the games, as soon as we leave, I pop on 590. I'm listening to the post game show. I love the call-in factor. People start talking or whatever. Of course, we're in our car talking. I'm debriefing with my son or my other friends, people talking or whatever. But for me, how I do it is, I'm on the road and I'm hustling it back up, another 2 hours back up to Portland, and so it'd be kind of fun to be able to just pop on that Twitter space, be able to be active in that Twitter space, as you're just tooling at home, driving home, no matter where you're at. I think you could really build this thing as doing like a post game show. Pre-game show might be a little more difficult because of tailgating and everything else like that, but definitely the post-game show as soon as the game's over. And Max Torres, he told me I should do some live YouTube where you just pop on and go with the comment section and everything else. And I've never even done that.
That'd be cool.
And so I did it at the Alamo Bowl during the halftime of the Alamo Bowl, and it was crazy. People were just all about it. And so I do think that there's so many different avenues for this. And I think that Duck fans are hungry for it. So the more we can satisfy that palate, the better for everybody.
Yeah, and it sucks because I feel like radio's dying slowly, and the paid Twitter spaces and Twitter space is going to be the next venue for radio.
Yeah. Why not? Or the podcast, right? So
Oh,
The podcast is already killing radio. People told me this last year. Every game I go to, people are like, "Hey, Sports Chat," and guys will tell me, they're like, "Hey," and I ask them, "How do you watch the show? Are you at home?" To me, I'm kind of old school, right? I'm 43, so I'm thinking people are sitting at home on a computer watching it. They're like, "No, I never even seen a computer. I watched it on my phone. I'm at work, or I'm like, I'm in the car driving." And so many guys told me that they listened to it on their car. In their car, like on the way to work, through their car speakers, and I'm like, "Whoa, amazing! This is even possible," because here I am, I'm still listening to sports radio in the morning on the way to work.
I normally listen to like my podcasts on like my drive to work or coming home from school or just like going to the gym, whatever.
Yeah, the podcast has totally changed the game. So to have kind of this Twitter space, it almost feels like a live podcast where you get people all involved with it, all talking about what's happening right then and there. And the Twitter space was just so addicting during that coaching search. Like, it felt like if you weren't on there, you were missing something. Now, it doesn't mean that it's 100% all the time quality info. I mean, there are people go on a rant and start talking about their grandma or something and
food.
Do it. But yeah, oh yeah, the food thing. It's like, oh yeah, how do you guys eat peanut butter sandwiches in the South, right? But my point is, like, there's something to be said about everybody trying to get the information at the same time and then sharing their, you know, reaction to that information live. I think that's a very cool aspect to that. And I think that's what I'm trying to tap in more with my own YouTube channel, yeah, is try to get more of that interaction as it's happening.
Yeah, and I feel like the Twitter spaces are just going to get better. I know people have been wanting more emojis, for example. So I think Twitter space is just going to get revolutionized and get better as time goes on, which is going to help a lot.
I mean, just like think about the shouts out to Chad, right?
Oh, yeah.
Little Chad, right? I followed homie. I mean, come on, dude. You have to, man. Like, why would you not, you know? I'll have him on here one of these days.
I've been helping out Chad, actually. I think this week or next week, he's going to have an interview with Devin Jackson, the four-star linebacker in the 2022 class. And then I kind of helped him out, give some tips after the Jaden Lemur, and kind of hooked him up with that one too.
Love it. I think that's the coolest thing out here, right? The coolest thing is, how do you pass it on? How do you encourage other people? And how do you just kind of spread the love of what the Ducks are doing? I've always been a passionate. Again, I started my channel as just kind of a thing. I just wanted to talk about the Ducks. And I've seen other people start their channels. I love it. I love what everybody's doing. I try to support the whole group. If I could have everybody on the same call at the same time, I think that'd be phenomenal, you know? Guys like Tyson Alger crack me up completely. Guys, super smart guys. You know, obviously guys like Krapia, who are just locked in on the yeah, program, know every single element of the thing. But also I just love hearing the parents. I love hearing the community members coming in and talking. And I like also hearing the people who are like completely bewildered. Like, I don't know really what to say here, but I think I'm supposed to say go Ducks, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, it's awesome. It's funny. The Twitter space is cool because we get those avid listeners, and then we get the avid fans that either they always want to comment something bad or comment something good about Oregon. And then, of course, we get the constant daily guys, their people. But I appreciate everyone on the Twitter space. It's always good talking to everyone and just getting their info, and especially James too. He always helps out on the numbers aspect with recruiting and just everything in general with the Oregon football team.
Yeah, just giving solid information. I mean, you know, even it's hilarious listening to Key or whatever. He's like, you know, I don't know. Why is this happening? He's the guy who's just like, I'm really confused, man. It's like, why aren't we the best? it's a classic format. So can't thank you enough. Jonathan, man, this has been awesome. Love talking with you. Thank you so much for joining on our little live stream as well for the YouTube, the sports chat. And again, spaces, anywhere else we can get a hold of you, man, let's do it, man.
Yeah, follow me on Twitter, like I mentioned earlier. And then on ScoopDuck on 3 for all that recruiting information. This next couple of weeks are going to be busy with early signing period coming on the second weekend of February. And then, of course, we'll start with the 2023 class in the next couple of weeks, too, with the spring game. A bunch of recruits are going to be there and everything, and it's going to be fun.
All right. Well, can't thank you enough, man. Go Ducks, and have yourself a great one, bud.
Later.